Thank you, Devin. So it's a tough task to follow Madam Subodha, and I think she has told you the most critical part of evaluating angle erosion, because what is happening that we are seeing a lot of patients coming to our OPD, given lifelong treatment with medical therapy and even operated trabeculectomy, where gonioscopy was not done. Patient actually had an open angle diagnosed and started medical therapy because gonioscopy was not done. Patient had a narrow angle and this iridotomy would have served the purpose. The patient went on to have a trabeculectomy just because gonioscopy was not done. So I think it's very important to do gonioscopy, and like Madam has highlighted, in a dark room with narrow slit, that is very critical to identify the angle structures. So whenever you put in a gonioscope, there are certain questions you need to answer. So I'm just simplifying. You put in a gonioscope. First thing is the angle open or closed? If you can see the serial spur, that means angle is open, it is unlikely to close, number one. Number two, is the iris touching the trabecular meshwork? That is the second important question you have to answer. And if it is touching, what is the extent of the contact between the iris and the trabecular meshwork? Thirdly, if you put in a gonioscope, the angle appears narrow, but trabecular meshwork is visible, then you have to identify, is there any evidence that previously there was trabecular meshwork contact with the iris? That means patient is having intermittent attacks of angle closure, and that is in the form of pigment clumps. Now once you have identified that there is a iridotomic trabecular contact, you have to answer the question whether this contact is reversible or no. That is basically distinguishing appositional closure from sinusoidal closure. When you comment on the angle opening, two other things you have to comment on is the amount of angle pigmentation and the type of iris configuration, like convex iris configuration or the sine wave configuration in bladder iris. Patients who are referred with diabetic retinopathy or vascular occlusion, before you dilate, put in a gonioscope to see if there are any vessels in the angle. And of course, for developmental anomalies, very important signs are the presence of anterior insertion of the iris in the form of dominant iris processes or anterior displaced solvate line. And more often than not, you have to identify why your trabeculectomy has failed. So you have to put in a gonioscope and study the patency of the ostium of trabeculectomy and view the implants like the anulocumab well to study the ostium. So these are the diagnostic uses of gonioscopy. But if you see modern day surgery, a lot of ab internal surgery is going on. So you have to learn to use the gonioscope in the operating table, like the therapeutic use of gonioscopy, both for laser trabeculoplasty as well as for a number of new surgeries that cannulate the Schlemm's canal. So the first question is that what are the angle structures visible? You have stationed the patient on the slit lamp and put in the gonioscope. So now you can see this is an open angle. You can see the middle band is the trabecular meshwork visible. So this is the trabecular meshwork visible and this is the serial spur visible. So this is an open angle. You can see the serial spur and the trabecular meshwork. So this is a wide open angle in a patient of primary open angle glaucoma, and again the hallmark that the serial spur is visible. Similarly, the other angle, view of the superior angle, you can see this pigmented band, trabecular meshwork, posterior to it the wide zone visible, the serial spur. So this is very easy to identify that you are dealing with an open angle, because the trabecular meshwork is easily visible with a serial spur behind it. So there is no query on this. This is a patient definitely with an open angle. So once you learn to identify the serial spur, you are sure patient is not at risk for developing an angle closure. Little bit you can see now silty body has started to appear. As I told you, you might get different types of angle pigmentations when you see an open angle. This is a patient with an open angle, and you can see here the ciliary body band is visible with much heavier pigmentation as compared to the previous patient. Serial spur visible, trabecular meshwork visible, ciliary body band visible. This is a wide open angle on gonioscopy. When you see patients who are pseudophakic or who have had a previous cataract surgery or any intraocular surgery, there is some amount of pigment spattering that occurs in the eye You can see this pigment, irregular patchy pigment, very densely pigmented angle. This chiral scar is visible. This is an open angle with a heavy pigment. So I've shown you the three types of pigmentation: light, moderate, and heavy pigment. This patient has got irregular pigmentation post cataract surgery. Another important thing is you make a slit beam and you see a continuous slit. You follow from the iris into the area of the skeletal scar to vecular meshwork. There is a continuous beam. Now this continuous beam is very different from what you will see in angle shoulder, and you can see that it's more or less a flat or a slightly concave iris. This is an open angle configuration. The other important thing is, whenever you put in a gonioscope and you see a uniform pigment like this, especially in the superior angle, because due to gravity sometimes you get heavy pigmentation of the anterior angle, especially like a previous patient post cataract surgery, but here you have a dense pigment both superiorly and inferiorly. This is the hallmark of a pigment dispersion syndrome. In no other condition will you get such uniform pigment present in the entire circumference of the angle. And when you put in a gonioscope, you will see in the superior angle this dense uniform band of pigment present. This is not seen in any other condition. So the diagnosis is a pigment dispersion syndrome or a pigmentary glaucoma. You can see in the superior angle dense pigment occluding the trabecular meshwork, causing a secondary rise in intraocular pressure. Coming to the next question, is there any evidence of iridotrabecular contact? This is perhaps the most important thing to learn in gonioscopy, to distinguish between an open angle and a closed angle. Now see this video carefully. You will see open angle in half the circumference, and here iris is occluding the trabecular meshwork. You can see this video again. This is very important to see. Here trabecular meshwork visible, from here it has become invisible because the iris has caught on. This is starting of perifer anterior synechia formation with angle closure. So this you can identify on gonioscopy, that the angle is starting to occlude, half open, half getting closed. The other important thing is to identify the presence of dense perifer anterior synechia. Now if you see this video carefully, you will see a central area where the skeletal spur and trabecular meshwork is visible. On either side, the iris has gone and blocked the trabecular meshwork. This is a typical video or how you see on the slit lamp in a patient of chronic angle closure glaucoma. Some areas may remain open, but the iris is now completely plastered onto the trabecular meshwork. So this is the hallmark of a primary angle closure disease, the peripheral anterior synechia formation causing occlusion of the angle structures with a rising intraocular pressure. The other question is that if you put in a gonioscope, angle is narrow but trabecular meshwork is visible, then you have to identify evidence of previous contact, that is in the form the iris has come in contact with the cornea and pulled back, it leaves some pigment. So you have to identify pigment clump. This is a very subtle sign and that can make the difference between your decision to do a laser iridotomy. Here you can see these fine pigment clumps are present in a narrow angle. The trabecular meshwork is visible. So whenever you have these fine pigment clumps present in a patient with a narrow angle in which trabecular meshwork is visible, that is a hallmark that there has been previous contact between the iris and the trabecular meshwork, leaving clumps of pigment. And this is a very important sign to identify an angle closure, the pigment clumps which are visible. As the disease progresses, when you put in a gonioscope, just remember the first video where you could see the skeletal spur and the trabecular meshwork. Here you see only the iris and this white area. So only the cornea and the iris is visible. There is no structure visible. This is the hallmark of a primary angle closure glaucoma. Complete angle closure, occluding the angle structures, no drainage, causing the secondary rise in intraocular pressure. You can see contrast from the first video, none of the angle structures are visible. This is a completely closed angle. Another patient, a completely closed angle, very convex iris, This is the hallmark of a synovial angle closure in a patient with primary angle closure glaucoma. The other critical question, there is a lot of confusion on this, on how to make the corneal wedge. So when you put in a goniscope, how to identify the landmarks of the angle? Many times I have seen that we have been teaching residents for 3 to 4 months, and many of them have seen that the edge of the goniscope they identify as the trabecular meshwork or the serial spur. So it is very important, if you are not able to see the trabecular meshwork or the CG body band, how to identify the Schwalbe's line. Why this is important? You put in a goniscope, you see this pigmentation present here. So many of times this will be confused as the trabecular meshwork. So how to identify whether this pigment, is it trabecular meshwork, is it something anterior to it, is it something posterior to it, because your other landmark which you are used to, the serial spur, is not visible. So for such a kind of pigmentation, to decide whether it is trabecular meshwork or no, you have to do the corneal wedge test. Another example, this patient was referred as a primary open angle glaucoma, and my resident said, sir, the trabecular meshwork is very nicely visible. So when you make the corneal wedge, you will see these two beams of light, the one coming from the corneal endothelium and one coming from the corneal epithelium, they are meeting at this point. So this pigmentation is anterior to the Schwalbe's line. So definitely it cannot be a trabecular meshwork. This is a pseudo pigment present anterior to the trabecular meshwork that you can diagnose by seeing the apex of the corneal wedge, which denotes the end of the decimates membrane or the starting point of the angle, which is the Schwalbe's line. So a 15 degree angulation or 20 degree angulation on the slit lamp, you can see these two beams of light, corneal endothelium, corneal epithelium, and at this point they are meeting. So this is the Schwalbe's line. That is how you do the corneal wedge test. If this apex is not visible, the iris is here, definitely it is a complete angle closure because the closure is anterior to Schwalbe's line. So always do this wedge test, see where the two beams are meeting, and that point is determining your Schwalbe's line. So this is the apex of the corneal wedge, which is your Schwalbe's line. Are there any other signs of angle closure apart from seeing the obstruction to the trabecular meshwork or the pigment clumps? So there are some subtle other signs to see. The first one is that you are putting a goniscope, convex iris configuration, angle structures are not visible. Now you saw the slit lamp in the patient with open angle, there was a continuity of the slit beam throughout. So here when you narrow the slit beam, you will see a difference between the slit lamp on the iris and on the cornea. There is a parallax. So this is a subtle sign to show you that the angle is closed. You cannot see the continuity of the beam. So it is dipping behind the iris into a very narrow angle. And of course, when you see this, you have to do manipulation to open up the angle. So this is the parallax. The beam from the cornea and the beam from the iris, there is a distance between them, unlike the open angle where there was a continuous beam going on the angle structure, and see the convexity of the iris. This has already been covered. This is a patient diagnosed angle closure, high IOP, post laser iridotomy. You put in a goniscope, you see this double hump sign, the first hump from the equator of the lens, the second hump from a prominent anteriorly displaced Schwalbe's line. So this is the sine wave configuration, which is the hallmark of a plateau iris configuration. Now coming to the other critical question, you have diagnosed that the trabecular meshwork is not visible. You have to answer now the question whether this contact between the iris and the trabecular meshwork, is it reversible or irreversible? By irreversible, I mean there is a synovial closure between the iris and the angle structures. See this patient carefully, angle structures are not visible, primary position. Now you ask the patient to look into the mirror. Now you see the angle opens up. This white area has become visible, so a part of the serial spur has become visible. So primary position, the angle was appearing closed. On manipulation, the angle has opened up. So you can report that in primary position, the trabecular meshwork was not visible, but on manipulating towards the cornea, aqueous is pushed into the angle, the angle opens up. This is done with a Posner or Sussman lens. This cannot be done with the Goldman type lenses. This is the indentation goniscopy. Primary position angle not visible. When you press the lens, angle opens up. See this carefully. Primary position angle is not visible. Now you are pressing. See very carefully. You have this peripheral anterior synechia or gonium synechia starting to appear. So you are pressing the gonioscope and you will see this fine filiform synechia have become visible in the angle. So it is very difficult to take the video indentation because you are inducing decimate folds in the angle. So the capturing is not a very good quality. But essentially I want to tell you these synechia have become visible. So this patient angle is completely opening up, appositional closure. Here you can see synechia. This patient has got synechial angle closure which you have tested using the Posner type of indentation gonioscope. Now as Dr. Amanji was also saying that all peripheral anterior synechia is not glaucoma, and you have seen the type of synechia in glaucoma. See this. These are totally different broad base synechia completely occluding the angle structure attaching to periphery of the cornea. This is a patient of Danlewetter uveitis. So this is a typical uveitic patient. Very dense anterior displaced iris, it is attaching to the periphery of the cornea where you have keratic precipitates occluding the angle structure. So this is the synechia formation, secondary angle closure occurring in a patient with Danlewetter's uveitis, and you have seen what is meant by a broad base synechia. Another patient of uveitis, a complete angle closure. This is a deep chamber and this pigment is anterior to the Schwalbe's line. Schwalbe's line will be somewhere here, and if you want to confirm, you do the corneal wedge test. You see the wedge is going to come somewhere here. So this is a complete synechial angle closure occurring in a patient with uveitis. Anybody from the audience? Anybody else?
Sipping out air.
So you try to concentrate on the lower picture. Very good. So this is one area is totally open, one area is caused by synechial closure. There is something else. Can you see this? Very good. So there is a new vessel coming from the ciliary body onto the trabecular meshwork. So this is a very subtle sign. Unless you know this, you will miss this. See this?
Neovascular.
So this patient referred with diabetic retinopathy. So the importance of gonioscopy, patient was not being referred for PRP. So he just came for checkup and we could detect the neovascularization of the angle. So the dictum is if the vessel crosses the scleral spur, that is pathognomic. So normally the vessel should not cross the scleral spur. If you have a vessel in the patient with a vascular occlusion or diabetic retinopathy crossing the scleral spur, arborizing on the trabecular meshwork, that is what we call neovascularization of the angle. And that is why this synechial closure is occurring. So immediately we referred the patient for pan-retinal photocoagulation, we could save the eye. And if you don't do this and patient comes maybe after another 4 weeks, then you will get a complete synechial angle closure. You can see the new blood vessel here. So there is a very little time frame for you. So before dilating diabetic patients or vascular occlusion patient, do the gonioscopy. You might detect neovascularization of the angle and save the patient's sight. Another patient presenting very late, ectropion UV, you can see the ciliary process visible and complete synechial angle closure. You can see the blood vessels here. So this is a very late stage, the type of synechial angle closure that occurs in patients with neovascular glaucoma. Now coming to a totally different scenario, you have seen a type of synechia in angle closure, you have seen the type of synechia in uveitis. But sometimes they are very dense iliotic corneal adhesions with a prominent anterior displaced Schwalbe's line. And see this picture, very different from angle closure. You can see this, there is a band of here present with iris tenting up and attaching to this band. You can see this band here. So this is the prominent anterior displaced Schwalbe's line with the iris going up and attaching very anteriorly onto the periphery of the cornea. This is typical of anterior segment degenesis. You will see this in Axenfeld-Rieger syndrome. So remember, very anteriorly displaced iris attaching to a prominent anteriorly displaced Schwalbe's line. You can see this, a very pigmented anteriorly displaced Schwalbe's line, the iris going and attaching to this line. As the iris contracts, you get the typical choretropia and polychoria seen in Axenfeld-Rieger syndrome. So this is the hallmark of a developmental anomaly of the angle seen in patients with juvenile glaucoma. Peripheral anterior displaced Schwalbe's line is segmented and the iris strand going and attaching to this. So whenever you put the gonioscope and see this, you can diagnose the patient as having a developmental anomaly of the angle. This is a patient of ICE syndrome. Here you will see very anterior synechia formation because there is also a problem in the corneal endothelium. So the iris goes and attaches to the periphery of the corneal endothelium. So you have very dense synechia formation in these cases, which is very anterior. The other question that was partly answered in the previous talks, how to distinguish prominent iris processes versus peripheral anterior synechia. So there are a lot of differences given in the book, but you have a look and you will realize what is the difference. Whenever you see these fine filiform iris processes which follow the concavity of the angle in a patient with a deep anterior chamber, they will constrict to light stimulus and not occlude the angle structures. So this is what is known as iris processes. This is typical of a developmental arrest in the angle. So the iris has failed to recede back and completely exposed the trabecular meshwork. So these are prominent iris processes, very different from the synechia which you have seen in patient's angle closure. And this is a very subtle sign. You can see the iris is going and attaching to the trabecular meshwork. This is a 20-year-old girl with juvenile glaucoma, and this is what you call as an anterior insertion of the iris. A very deep chamber, the iris is creeping and attaching to the trabecular meshwork, not in that dramatic fashion of the iris processes. But this is a very important sign to pick up. This is called an anterior insertion of the iris in a patient with juvenile glaucoma. Again, a patient, fine filiform iris processes. Now contrast this with peripheral anterior synechia. This is again a patient with dense iris processes. This is again a patient with Axenfeld-Rieger syndrome. You can see the pigmented anterior Schwalbe's line and the iris strand going and attaching to it. So this, whenever you see this picture, you are sure that this patient has got a developmental angle anomaly, what we call as anterior segment dysgenesis. Now contrast that iris processes with this. This is peripheral anterior synechia. You can see convexity of the iris is tented up, occluding the angle structures, very different from what you saw previously, the iris processes, which were fine filiform. So this is peripheral anterior synechia formation. Then another very important thing which is often missed, the children coming in with concussion injuries and they present maybe 10 years later with a blind eye because gonioscopy was not done at that time. So put in a gonioscope. See the difference, very wide prominent ciliary body band is visible here. A very wide prominent ciliary body band under the ciliary spur, trabecular meshwork ciliary spur, and very wide ciliary body band visible. Important thing, always compare with the fellow eye, don't comment on just one eye. You can see the other part of the angle, very wide ciliary body band is visible. This is only visible superiorly, the inferior angle was okay and the other eye was also normal. So always see the entire circumference of the angle. If you see irregular widening of the ciliary body band, that is the hallmark of what we call as angle recession. Patient requires long-term screening to rule out late rising intraocular pressure. This is of course typical iridodialysis, disinsertion of the iris from the ciliary body in a patient who has had a cricket ball injury. Now this patient, we are using the coepis lens before surgery. There is a disinsertion of the ciliary body from the sclera. This is what is known as a cyclodialysis cleft. Because these patients have got hypotony, difficulty to gonioscopy. So on the OT table, you might have to inject viscoelastic and then this cleft will become visible. So this is the cyclodialysis cleft because sclera is visible here. So there's a disinsertion of the iris ciliary body complex from the sclera. And this patient will require direct repair. And of course, you have to do under gonioscopy. After you do the repair, again you do gonioscopy and you will see that that cleft is no longer visible. Is of course you are aware the emulsified silicone oil. This gives one of the most beautiful pictures on gonioscopy. Look like pearls in the angles. This is the hyperoleum patients with post-vitrectomy rise in intraocular pressure, which you can pick up on gonioscopy. And coming to the last section of my talk is the changes after trabeculectomy. This is very critical because many patients come with rising intraocular pressure, maybe immediately or later on, and you have to understand what is going on. I'll give you one example. Patient presents post-surgery with high IOP, and normally you do a leg massage. But if you do gonioscopy and you see that the iris is attached to the ostium, you should not do a leg massage. So when you put in a gonioscope in a patient operated trabeculectomy, you will see that in the superior angle, there is a cleft visible here. So this cleft in the sclera is the trabeculectomy ostium. You can see the iridectomy and this cleft is visible. So this is a patent trabeculectomy ostium visible in a patient who has undergone trabeculectomy for primary open hand glaucoma. You can see the trabecular mesh for the iridectomy and this patent ostium in the sclera. This is very important to identify for patients who have undergone trabeculectomy. Another patient, patent trabeculectomy ostium, there is a band of pigment that is coming to the edge, but the ostium is open. You can see posteriorly the trabecular meshwork and iridectomy. So learn to identify the patent trabeculectomy ostium, this one, post glaucoma surgery. Why I told you to see for this, you will see this patient, you can see now the difference. The iris is going and blocking the ostium. This part is open, but the other half, it is being blocked by the iris. So this is very important sign to pick up. This is the cause of failure, and in such a patient, never do blood massage because it is going to further incarcerate the iris. You can see the iris going and blocking the ostium. This is the cleft in the sclera, and this half is being blocked by the iris. That is why it is very important to do gonioscopy in the postoperative period to identify whether your trabeculectomy is functional or whether it is occluded by iris or pigment or the hyphema. If you have put in a glaucoma drainage device till enamel glaucoma valve, you do gonioscopy because sometimes the tube may be blocked by a capsule, lens capsule or hyphema or debris. So on gonioscopy you can identify the patent ostium of the enamel glaucoma valve and establish what is the cause of failure. And the last part of my talk, I have told you the diagnostic uses of gonioscopy. But nowadays we are moving towards gonioscopy guided surgery, and unless you know the anatomy, it becomes very difficult. So one of the new techniques coming up for angular closure glaucoma is the goniosynovialysis. This is a patient after cataract surgery on the table. This is a Swan-Jacob lens, so I am inserting the Helion cannula and teasing away the iris from the trabecular meshwork. So you open up the area of the trabecular meshwork, you can see the sclera spur becoming visible. So this is under gonioscopic guidance, and unless you know the anatomy, you can cause more damage because you can hit any of the structures. So identify this trabecular meshwork, tear off the iris from the trabecular meshwork. So this is a new technique which can be used for angular closure glaucoma. If it is not very late, it may open up the angle structures and decrease. This should not be done in a phakic patient. So these are patients who have already undergone cataract surgery. This is a new technique, the hydrus implant. This is an intracanalicular stent. You are seeing the implant being injected into the Schlemm's canal. So these are new intracranial implants. Of course, the use in India, that is totally separate issue of debate. But I'm just showing you that gonioscopic guided surgery is being done, and unless you know the various techniques of gonioscopy, it is very difficult to do these surgeries on the table. So where to read about gonioscopy? There's a DVD we have produced from AIOS on gonioscopy, which you can get. And from the last 10 years at RP Center, we have compiled this text and atlas, and also this includes the gonio videos of how the gonioscopy is visible in a patient or different clinical conditions. And as you have seen, this requires a lot of clinical material. And I just want to thank my residents, because I am after their life 24/7, and it is because of three of them, Rohit, Manish and Amir Sobti, that I could present these numerous videos. Out of capturing maybe 100 videos, only 10 come out in high quality. Thank you very much for your kind attention.